Welcome to 3SN, everybody. I'm Alex D, and with me is James No Doubt Dotson. It is the most wonderful time of the year, the NCAA March Madness Tournament. And everyone's filling out brackets, everyone's filling out more than one bracket, trying to get in some winnings, trying to pick up their upsets. And there's just really no better sporting spectacle, in my opinion. Dotson, how's it going?
Hey, going well. We're here ready to help fill out your brackets to help maybe win you some of that money for your office pool because you're right. This is the best time of year because anybody can get involved. Anybody, you know, you don't have to know much about brackets, but the more you do, the better chance you have of winning, but you never know when that Cinderella can come and sweep everybody off their feet.
Well, I agree, and I think most people filling out brackets really don't know too much about college basketball. I think it's just the fun of it, filling out a bracket, getting in the office pool, seeing what happens. So if you don't really know much about college basketball, we're here to help. But anyway, let's get right into it. All right, let's start out in the Midwest region in Indianapolis. Louisville, the number one seed. Dotson, what should we look out for in this region?
Well, Louisville definitely has the inside track, but I'll tell you what, I think this entire Midwest region is very stacked. I think you have the best one seed, obviously, Louisville being number one overall. Duke, you can make an argument, should be a number one seed because while they've lost one game all year when they have Ryan Kelly in their lineup, Michigan State is probably the first, maybe second best number three seed. St. Louis is playing out of their minds right now as a four seed. And then you have Oregon, who won the Pac-12 tournament, as the 12 seed. So there's just lots of great teams. I didn't even mention Oklahoma State. Memphis won their conference tournament. There's lots of good quality teams. Creighton with McDermott. This seems like a stacked region, and really it's going to be tough to predict a winner out of this one.
I agree. When I first glanced at it, I had Louisville coming out of that region. I was kind of, you know, torn between Louisville and Duke, but I think I'm going to go with the Cards here. They won the Big East tournament. They're just, in my opinion, great complete team, great complete program. Love Rick Pitino, love the Cards. They won the Big East tournament, the last ever Big East tournament. Connecticut won it, I don't know if it was last year or the year before, winning the Big East tournament, then winning the March Madness tournament. A lot of people think they should go against the Big East champion because the physicality involved, your fatigue. But as we've seen, that's not always the case. So I like the Cards. I'm going to have them coming out of that region. But if there's one team we should look out for, which team should it be?
I think Michigan State. They always play well in March, so I think they have a great chance to go far. Duke, they scare me to take far in a tournament. I mean, they were number two seed last year. They lost to Lehigh in the first round because they couldn't hit their outside shots. When they play against bigger opponents, all of a sudden they stick too much to the outside shot. And that's what happened in the ACC tournament, and all of a sudden they shot 4 for 25 from outside. I think that they'll be fine against Albany and probably against either Creighton or Cincy in the second round because they can go inside to Plumlee for sure. However, if they play a team like Memphis or Michigan State who have a little bit more size, and definitely when they have to play Louisville with Gorgui Jang, I think that they're going to really have trouble going inside to Plumlee. Therefore, that I don't see Duke getting past the Sweet 16, but definitely not past the Elite 8, to be honest. So in the bottom half, I think either Duke or Michigan State getting up there, but I think it's going to be too tough not to pick Louisville to go all the way. Now, the fun thing about this region is that you do have some good upset opportunities. You know we like them. The one that I really like, I like the number 13, New Mexico State. And why is that? Because St. Louis's top rebounder is only 6'5". The tallest player who gets significant time, 6'8". New Mexico State has a guy by the name of Sim Bular who is 7'5". He plays 35 minutes a game, and he actually scores. I mean, it's not like he just, you know, sits there and does nothing. 16 points, 16 rebounds, 5 blocks in his championship game. I'm really anxious to see what St. Louis tries to do to stop him.
Very interesting. So give me your Sweet 16, your Elite 8.
All right, I got Louisville, and I'm going to take Oregon just because I think they're playing very well right now. And one of the guys that you want to look at, E.J. Singler, and if that name sounds familiar, that would be Kyle Singler's brother, the old Duke player. He leads the team with only 11.5 points per game. They're very balanced. They also have a guy by the name of Dotson on their team. So, I mean, he's like my seventh cousin, twice removed, I think, something like that. So I got to have a little props here to Oregon. And then I'll have Michigan State beating Duke in the bottom half. So Louisville beating Michigan State to make it to the Final Four in my mind. But again, there's so many great teams in this region. I can see this going many different ways. I mean, I could see, I could honestly see Missouri with Oriaki down low and with Phil Pressey dishing out 7 assists per game. I can see him doing a great game and possibly knocking out Louisville in the second round. Anything's possible, but I think going with the safety, Louisville's playing very well right now. I think I have to give the edge to them.
All right, well, there you go. So we both have the Cardinals coming out of the Midwest region in Indianapolis. Let's go down to the West bracket in Los Angeles. And Gonzaga is the number one seed in this region. Of course, my Pitt Panthers are in this region, so this is going to be the region I keep my eye on the most. But a lot of good teams here. You have Ohio State in number two. You have Notre Dame at 7. I know some people thought they should have been better than that. In your mind, what are some teams to watch out for?
Well, you definitely mentioned Notre Dame because they can shoot. When they hit their shots, they win games, period. They have a very tough matchup, though. Iowa State has 6 players who average 10 points per game or more on their roster. So that balanced scoring attack and a high-scoring attack, they're a top-5 scoring team in the country. That gives Notre Dame some trouble, I think. They're going to have to try to keep up. They do it by shooting outside. If they don't hit their shots, goodbye Fighting Irish. So I look at Iowa State as a team, possibly. However, I can't see them beating Ohio State because Ohio State's just, right now, they're playing the best basketball in America. They've won 8 straight games. Aaron Kraft is finally starting to look for his shot. He's driving the lane, and honestly, nobody can guard him. And if they try to guard him, if they try to stop him driving, he kicks it out, and DeShaun Thomas is just lights out. So Ohio State seemed like a very good pick to come out of the West region, and a big part of that is the fact that, they are, by the tournament standards, they are the top number 2 seed, with Gonzaga being the worst of the number 1s. And we all say it, Gonzaga really didn't play anybody this year. How good will they play? Yes, they have a 7-footer, Kelly Olynyk. Yes, they have John Stockton's son, David. Yes, they have Elias Harris. But we don't know how well they will do. And honestly, I've seen people taking them out as early as the Sweet 16 round, or even from the round of 32, not making it to the Sweet 16.
I definitely think it'd be an interesting matchup if Pitt does get past Wichita State. And honestly, I don't have them getting past them. I'll get that to them in a minute. But I think Steven Adams and Alun will be a great matchup, both big men. That would definitely be something to keep an eye on. And I think it's because Steven Adams from Pitt has been so inconsistent. He can dominate one game, and he could look like a non-factor in the next. So he's kind of a question mark there. So depending what Steven Adams shows up, it could be very dangerous and could knock off the number one seed Gonzaga. But I do have Wichita State winning, only because Pitt has just been an underachiever when it comes to tournaments. You know, often we say this will be the year Pitt finally gets deep into the tournament, and this has been going on ever since 2002. I mean, it's been going on this long. I think it's alarming. I don't think it's a fluke. I think it's kind of their ceiling in a way. I just think the way they play basketball, really scrappy, grinded out physical defense, and not really much flashy offense, and an inability to adapt to different styles of play in the tournament. They have a lot of trouble keeping up with the faster teams, especially with good, quick point guards. So until something really changes down in Oakland, PA, I don't see Pitt really ever advancing far in the tournament. I think they're 1-5 when they go up against the higher seed in their last 6 tournaments or something like that. It's a pretty alarming number. I can't remember exactly. But either way, Pitt's a team you stay away from until that whole program changes. So I have Pitt losing to Wichita State. But I have Ohio State coming out of that region. And it's kind of what you said, too. Gonzaga is the worst of the number one seeds, and they really haven't shown too much. So I might be in the minority, but I think the Buckeyes are probably more likely to come out of that region.
If I had to choose just between Gonzaga and Ohio State, I would choose Ohio State because of the way they're playing right now. And it's not like Gonzaga's playing poorly either. They haven't lost since their game against Butler, the Hoosiers reenactment back in mid-January. But still, just Ohio State's playing way too well. Now, here's my thing with Pitt, Alex. I think that with Steven Adams down low, they might Gonzaga might be forced to put Olynyk guarding him, and I think you can get a guy like Olynyk in foul trouble trying to guard a 7-footer himself. So, and I think that the other big guys for Pitt, the more athletic ones, you know, like the Robinsons of the world, they can be the athletic type that can stick with Kelly Olynyk on the outside. He's tough to beat because if you put an athletic guy on him, he goes low. If you put a smaller guy or a bigger guy on him who's not as quick, he'll just drive right by. I think Pitt has guys who can guard him well. I actually have Pitt making a second-round upset on Gonzaga. That is probably my biggest upset in my bracket. I just feel when I go with filling out a bracket, I look at the matchups, and I think this matches up very well for Pitt over Gonzaga. And I think beyond that, I also look at what happens down the road for Gonzaga. They would have to play a very athletic and very big team in Wisconsin. I wouldn't see them getting past them either. Kansas State, another team that they could face there. I don't see that happening. So I end up having Pitt beating Gonzaga. I have Wisconsin then beating Pitt to go to the Elite Eight. But I don't have them facing Ohio State, in fact. I have New Mexico coming out of this West Regional. And really, there's nothing flashy about this team. I mean, they don't have a standout star that we all know about. They just get the job done. And the main guy that they have is Kendall Williams. They have a balanced attack. He has about 14 points per game. The other thing they have a big guy, 7-footer Alex Kirk. I think he can take down anybody when he goes down low. Again, he could go and face a Kelly Olynyk and get him in foul trouble and take him out of a game. Alex Kirk, 12 points, 8 rebounds per game. He's their success, and that's why I have New Mexico going to the Final Four.
Oh, well, there you have it. I have the Buckeyes, and Jimmy has New Mexico. So we differ in that region, but if you're going to pick an upset team to come out of the region, go with New Mexico.
Yeah, this seems to be, for some reason, I think, you know, maybe the weakest, or it appears that way on paper, because the 4 and 5 seeds, Wisconsin, Kansas State, they haven't been great this year. Gonzaga, I mean, I won't call them a mid-major anymore, but they might as well be a smaller conference school, so it doesn't look as good on paper. Ohio State is the 2, but then another, New Mexico, a team from the Mountain West that a lot of people don't know much about, that they'll be fearful to take them. So on paper, it looks weak, and honestly, I think that New Mexico especially can surprise some people. And I could see Gonzaga going far, too. I just, personally, with the matchups, I think that a team like Pitt can go and take them out.
Oh, well, there you have it. You know, I hope Pitt could take them out, but my heart and my mind say two different things. Anyway, moving on to the South region in North Texas, we have the Kansas Jayhawks as the number one overall seed. And we've got a couple interesting matchups here. We have VCU at number 5 taking on Akron. A lot of people think Akron can win that game, but the matchup I'm looking mostly at is Michigan versus South Dakota State. And this whole year, I really have not been that impressed with Michigan. We've seen Penn State give them trouble. We've seen Pitt give them trouble. They just kind of seem to fit the mold for a potential upset pick. What do you have to say about that?
All right, if they were facing a team that had a dominant inside presence, I would take Michigan to lose in a heartbeat because they just don't do enough on the inside. However, I also look what happened to them last year. They played a MAC school, a very small school that were able to spread out and play against the smaller team of Michigan. Michigan, when they face a team like that, or any big school when they play a mid-major team like that who spreads it out, needs to have a big guy that they can just give the ball down low and pound away. Michigan doesn't have that. They don't have a consistent scorer. And what is South Dakota State going to do? Nate Walters. He's a Wooden Award nominee. He's going to do that all night long. He not only scores over 20 points per game, but he is close to 10 assists per game. He, in my mind, is a better point guard than Trey Burke for Michigan. And that's saying something. I think it's going to be great to watch those two do battle. Put it this way. If Walters didn't get in foul trouble last year, they would have beaten Baylor. That's just the way I look at it. He's better this year. His team around him is better this year. I think South Dakota State, the Jackrabbits, take down the Michigan Wolverines in the first round. I just don't see Michigan being consistent enough with their outside shot and with the lack of a big guy.
I agree. I have South Dakota State winning also. I have Kansas moving on to face UNC. Not really been impressed with Villanova this year. I would have gotten a chance to watch them a lot. They just seem like a team that could be really hit or miss, in my opinion. So I'm going to have Kansas coming out of there going out to the Elite Eight, I should say. I think a team to watch out for is VCU. I really, really like Shaka Smart. I think he's an excellent coach. I mean, he made a Final Four a few years ago. He knows how to win in the tournament. So that's something to keep an eye on. I also going down the region a little bit, UCLA and Minnesota. You know, I've been wanting to pick UCLA because Ben Howland's been coaching for his job. He's on the hot seat. Loved him when he was at Pitt. But they lost one of their star players in the tournament, so I'd be a little hesitant to pick them. So this could be a potential upset, don't you agree?
Yeah, definitely, because, like you said, Jordan Adams, he broke his foot there in the Pac-12 tournament, trying to block a shot in the last play of a game. I think that was the semifinal matchup. And so he's out. He was one of their catalysts. I mean, yes, they have Shabazz Muhammad, who's been great for them, but it's when Jordan Adams plays well that the team as a whole seems to do well, because Muhammad will always do well, but he needs that guy next to him to help in the assisting with getting that team to where they need to be. So with Adams out, I think we're going to be have to go with Minnesota, especially they're a big and athletic team. UCLA seems to have trouble with that. I actually have Minnesota winning that game, and I have them beating Florida. Now, I'm not a fan of Florida for this reason. I think that as a power conference team, you should not be shooting an average of 23 three-pointers per contest, and that's what Florida has done this year. You live by the three, and you die by the three. I mean, I look at it this way. They were up huge on Mississippi in the SEC title game this weekend, and they blew it because they couldn't go inside to try to waste clock. They couldn't make a shot from the outside. All of a sudden, you know, they give up a huge lead and game over. I don't see Florida going far. Honestly, if you're bold, I wouldn't have a problem with picking Northwestern State because they're actually the highest scoring team in college basketball. So I would even look at if Florida, I mean, I definitely wouldn't take Florida to the Sweet 16. I think Minnesota or UCLA could take them down. But if you're bold, I would have no problem in you going with the Northwestern State Demons because they shoot well, they rebound well, top 10 rebounding team, top 20 assisting team, shooting 47% as a team, and they put 4 on the board. What else do you need?
Georgetown, a lot of people have the Hoyas coming out of this region. I do, too. I watch them in the Big East. I like the way they play. I think they're a really tough team. How far do you see the Hoyas going out in this region?
Looking at the matchups, they match up well with a lot of the teams that they will face in here, whether it would be, say, Oklahoma or San Diego State. I think that they're too big, and that zone is going to work too well against either one of those teams that don't have prolific outside scorers to try to break them out of it. If they were to face Florida, it could be interesting trying to have a zone team who packs it in against the outside shooting squad. However, Georgetown on offense can just pound it down low. I think they would win that. Minnesota, same sort of thing. No outside shooter. Bigs versus bigs. That will be an old school game if those two face off. And then who would they face out of the top? Most likely Kansas. Again, I think that they can really limit what McLemore can do that way. So I, too, have Georgetown going all the way to the Final Four. Now, here's the thing. I have them playing Kansas in the Elite Eight. I had to think about that one for a long time because whether Kansas plays North Carolina or Villanova in the second round, I really like their chances of being upset. North Carolina has athletic guys who are very tall. They like to run up and down the court. I don't know how well McLemore and Withy and company can do in a up-and-down game that North Carolina is going to force them to play. And as for Villanova, yes, you mentioned it earlier that they're not exactly the great team that they've been in the past, and they've been kind of up and down at times this year. But it's, I mean, they got Mutal Yeru, who I think can take out Withy down low. But they also have Archie Diacchio, who when he plays, and he's their point guard. He's inexperienced, but he's very confident, almost a little cocky. That's the thing. If he goes and plays his game that he knows he can play, I think that they could actually pull off an upset. I'm not confident enough to pick it because I got to look at what will happen down the road. But I could see Villanova and definitely could see UNC possibly pulling that upset off. So again, if you're feeling a little bold or if you have a big bracket incentives for picking upsets, don't be afraid to pick that 8 or 9 team to beat Kansas there.
All right, well, there you have it. That's going to be an interesting region to watch out. I have Kansas and Georgetown battling it out, but I have Georgetown winning the South region, and that's a popular pick. I know a lot of people like Kansas because they just won the tournament. They're kind of on a roll there, but can't go against the Hoyas, in my opinion, there. But let's move on to the East region. In Washington, D.C., This is a very interesting region. I think both you and I earlier stated that we had some upsets coming out of here. Indiana's the number one seed overall in this region. You know, we have the Syracuse Orange. They're playing pretty good basketball. But Davidson, in my opinion, is a team to watch out for. I think they're on like a 17-game win streak. I can't remember the exact number, but they're probably the hottest team in college basketball right now. And when it comes to tournaments, I'm always about going with the hot hand. What have you done for me lately? So I have Davidson upsetting Marquette here, and I have them making a pretty decent run. How do you feel about Davidson?
I like them. I mean, you mentioned they haven't lost since mid-January, and in that time, Marquette has lost like 5 or 6 games. Now, it's against very different opponents, that's for sure. What scares me is that Davidson doesn't exactly have, you know, that Stephen Curry type player that they had back when they made their Elite Eight run back in the mid-2000s. So I'm not sure if I want to take them to the Elite Eight like you have them. I'm not even sure I want to take them in the first round just because Marquette, Buzz Williams, they know how to play. They can play pretty much against any team. They've shown it time after time. They can play with a fast, high-octane type team. They can play with a slow-it-down team. So I think Marquette, honestly, I think Marquette is a very disappointing first-round matchup for Davidson. Davidson could have beaten pretty much any other 3 seed that they would have possibly faced. I think that Marquette is going to be a bit too much for them, but I commend you. Again, this is another 3-14 matchup. Honestly, any of the 3-14s, I wouldn't have much problem, or I wouldn't criticize you for trying to pick one of those upsets because you can do very well with it. Valpo over Michigan State, even Harvard over New Mexico. I had New Mexico going to the Final Four, but I had to think about the first-round matchup because of an Ivy League school. So I'm not disappointed with your thought on Davidson. I like Jake Cohen. They also, I mean, he's 6'10". What else do you need to know? They have an inside presence that a lot of mid-majors don't. So that will be a fun game to watch, and I hope for your sake that Davidson wins, but I personally have Marquette winning. You have a lot of upsets. I don't have as many in this one. It's very interesting how we can see this one region going so many different ways.
Oh, I have Temple over NC State. I had Cal over UNLV. I wouldn't say I have that many upsets other than that, but in the first round, I do have Syracuse upsetting Indiana. And I know, you know, this has been a pretty good year for the Big Ten. Maybe it's because it's the last year of the Big East and my heart's kind of going with these Big East teams, but I'm going to go with Syracuse over Indiana here. And other than that, I think my matchup's pretty set, and I'm pretty confident with my Final Four. But then again, we've had the last few years 8 seeds, 9 seeds, you know, making it in. Maybe that's going to come back to bite me in the butt, but for some reason, I see a lot of upsets in the first few rounds, but when it all comes down to it, when it gets to the Final Four, I think it's going to be pretty basic.
I think that, you know, maybe it's just me, but I don't like the higher seeds. I don't think Cal deserved to make it to the tournament, for example. Actually, the only upset I have in that entire East region is Temple beating NC State. Other than that, I'm right down the board with the seeding. So it always seems like that happens at sometimes. But yeah, I have Indiana going the whole way. I think Oladipo on defense and from the outside, especially with a guy like Jordan Holes who shoots about 50% from 3-point range, combine that with the 7-footer Zeller, I think Indiana is going to be way too much for any team in that region. And I really like Miami. I mean, I've liked them from day one. I've loved watching them go through this tournament. I really can't stand that they didn't get a number one seed. However, I think Miami is good enough with Larkin out there to make it to the Elite Eight. I don't think they match up well against Indiana, though, so that's why I have to take Indiana making it to that Final Four. So I'll have Georgetown facing off against Indiana, and then on the other side, Louisville versus New Mexico. So I got 2 Big East, a Big Ten, and a Mountain West in my Final Four.
Wow. Well, I have 3 Big East and 1 Big Ten. So maybe my heart's getting in the way of my reason here. But I have the Louisville Cardinals winning the NCAA tournament. Like I said, all the reasons before why I like the Cardinals, but Tino, I like the way they've been playing. They're hot. Just to me, I think it's theirs to lose. I really do. So we'll see what happens, but Louisville Cardinals are my pick to win the NCAA tournament.
And I can't argue with that pick. I mean, they are the number one overall seed, so you really can't argue it at all. Now, as for me, I think that Peyton Thiva, their point guard, he sometimes gets into these funks where he doesn't score. And that's what scares me. I mean, I really hesitated getting them to the Final Four. I had to put them there because of how well they are playing now, and especially when you have guys like Gorgui Dieng down low. I'd love to see a championship matchup with Louisville versus Indiana, a guy like Dieng versus Zeller down low, Oladipo taking on Peyton Thiva outside. I think it will be a great matchup, and I would go with, honestly, they've been the best team from start to finish this year in my mind. I have to go with the Indiana Hoosiers to make it to the championship game and to win the national championship.
Well, there you have it. That was the 3SN bracket breakdown for the 2013 March Madness tournament. It's the most wonderful time of the year, like I said earlier. Just have some fun filling out your brackets and fill out one bracket. A lot of people fill out a lot and they get one right and they think this is the best, but if you want to do it the right way, fill out one and make it public.
You know why? Because guess what? If you filled out every single possible bracket you could, if you paid one penny for every bracket that you could possibly fill out, you would pay off the United States national debt about 100 million times. So stick with one bracket. It doesn't matter. Go with your gut. Filling out 10 brackets and saying, oh, I had that upset in my one bracket, doesn't mean much of anything. So use us. Let us know what you guys think. Where we're right, where we're wrong. We'd love to hear your feedback. We'd love to hear what you guys have to say. So good luck in your bracket. Hope you guys win some money, and we hope that we can help you along the way. But now it's show.